This video will be explaining about the nephron complete system. In the previous video, we have studied about the structure and the working of the nephrons, that is the different parts of the nephrons, how they function. Now, if we further go in detail, we find that the nephron system, or the nephron, which is the filtering unit, is having two major parts, that is the renal corpuscle, and the second is the tubular system or the renal tubules. Now, the renal corpuscle consists of the glomerulus and the Bowman's capsule, where actually the filtration takes place. Whereas it consists, this actually it leads further, this Bowman's capsule and the glomerulus, they are led to the tubular system or the system of renal tubules, which play major role in the reabsorption and the secretions of the useful product, that is the reabsorption of the important metabolites and the electrolytes, and the secretion also takes place over here. So the tubular system consists of four major tubules. That is the proximal convoluted tubule, Henle's loop, followed by the distal convoluted tubule and the collecting duct. The proximal convoluted tubule is known as the PCT, and the distal convoluted tubule, we will be referring it as DCT. Now, when we are studying about the functioning of the nephron, it is also very important to understand that the nephrons are the filtering units, and whatever electrolytes, depending upon the metabolic requirement of the body, the electrolytes which are being filtered are again reabsorbed. So we will be studying in this section what is the role of the renal tubules. Let us first get started with the proximal convoluted tubule, or we will be referring it as PCT. Now, this PCT is actually starting from the area that is soon after the Bowman's capsule. It is here, and the glomerular structure is here. This is followed by the PCT. So, PCT area is a convoluted tubular system, and it is lined by simple cuboidal brush border epithelial cells. Now, the cuboidal cells which are lining over here are very closely packed. Also, they have very fine hairs, the brush border, and they were close to each other. So these brush border cells having microvilli are densely packed. So we call this as the microvilli. These type of cells line the PCT. Now, the microvilli actually increase the surface area for reabsorption of essential nutrients. Whatever nutrients are required, they are reabsorbed in the PCT. And around 70 to 80% of various electrolytes are taken in. Its second important thing is it helps in maintaining the pH and the ionic balance. That is because most of the movement takes place through the ions. So it helps in maintaining the ionic balance of the body fluids. There is selective secretion. That means certain substances are added and certain are removed. So here we have hydrogen, potassium, ammonium into filtrate and absorption of various other useful substances take place. So it maintains the pH, it helps in maintaining pH, ionic balance, then selective secretion takes place over here, and reabsorption of useful substances. So this is very, very important. Now, over here, the cells have large number of mitochondria to provide sufficient amount of energy for the active absorption as well as the secretion. Now, after this PCT, that means after the Bowman's capsule leads to PCT, and from here it goes to the Henle's loop. This is the descending and this is the ascending limb of Henle's loop. Now, when we talk of the Henle's loop is very, very important, but over here in the Henle's loop, when we are talking, there is almost or very less, almost nil or very less reabsorption. So this area does not have the reabsorption, that is the Henle's loop, and it has two limbs to form the counter current mechanism. Counter current mechanism will be just studying in detail. It is having actually, this is the descending limb of Henle's loop and this is the ascending limb of Henle's loop. Now both the loops, both the limbs have different functions. Now over here, there are in this area, that is the descending limb, it is highly permeable to water. That means it is having membrane, that it is a narrow duct compared to the descending limb. It is narrow, the lumen is very thin over here, and this is slightly thicker. This is the ascending limb. Now this area is highly permeable to water. That means it allows the movement of the water and it is not permeable to NaCl, or that is sodium and chlorine ion. So if we talk of the descending limb is highly permeable to water and not permeable to sodium ion and Cl ion, etc. Or we say other electrolytes. Now, when this is not happening, that means water is, and also remember this zone over here, it is present in the cortex area, and this area, that is the Henle's loop and the DCT and all, it is present within the medulla region. That is why the striations, we have already discussed this. So this medulla region, and this is lying in the cortex region, upper portion. Till here it is the cortex and the down portion is in the medulla. So what is happening over here? Since lot of water is being excreted or is secreted out, and very less amount of electrolytes are moving out in the medullary fluid, because this area is surrounded within the medullary fluid. So what is happening over here? This causes an increase in the concentration of the filtrate. So what is happening because of all this, because it is permeable to water and not permeable to this, the electrolytes remain within the tubule, and as a result it concentrates the filtrate. The filtrate is concentrated as it is moving down through the tubular system. Coming to this ascending limb of Henle's loop, it is just the opposite. It is lined by flat epithelial cells, and this zone is not permeable to water. That means just the opposite. And over here, it is highly permeable to sodium ions, that is the movement of the sodium ions is taking place over here, and Na, that is, and chlorine also. So it continuously releases chlorine and sodium, and it releases water in the medullary fluid. Now what is happening because of the ascending limb? Ascending limb is just the opposite. It is highly permeable. Highly permeable to electrolytes, Na plus and Cl minus, and not permeable to water. So this actually dilutes the filtrate, because a lot of electrolytes get removed and water is present within the tubular system. As a result, it allows the dilution of the filtrate, and the electrolytes are passed into the medullary fluid. Now this actually balances, or it maintains the ionic balance and the osmotic pressure within the medullary fluid, which will help in better filtration. Now coming to the distal convoluted tubular system, it is a coiled area, but it is less coiled than the PCT. PCT is more coiled than the DCT, and it is lined by cuboidal epithelial cells. So coming to the DCT, distal convoluted tubular system, it is lined by cuboidal epithelial cells. So we have cuboidal epithelial cells over here. Which are present very few microvilli, because this is not the area over here. As unlike PCT, it was richly having the brush border cells. Very less microvilli present over here in this area, and in this area the selective secretion takes place. Conditional reabsorption of sodium and water takes place. So over here, conditional reabsorption of sodium and water takes place. It is depending upon the metabolic need of the body. To maintain the amount content of water, that is the amount of water within the body, whether more or less, depend to maintain the ionic balance, the DCT will continue with the reabsorption of water or the sodium, and it maintains the pH also by secreting protons and by absorbing bicarbonate. So it is capable of absorbing or taking in HCO3, and HCO3 helps in maintaining pH. So it maintains pH also. So, and also the sodium potassium balance in the blood. Sodium potassium balance is very, very important to be in right proportion, because then various metabolic activities of the body are affected if it is not present appropriately. Now, last part of this is the collecting ducts. Now, all the DCT, that is the the DCT leads to the collecting tubular system. So the DCT, if we simplify this diagram, it will lead to a system which is collecting tubule, and these collecting tubule finally lead to the ureter. So these are the collecting ducts. Now these collecting ducts, they are very long, and they extend from the cortex region, that is, this is the cortex region, to the inner parts of the medulla. And these collecting tubules will reach to the renal pelvis area that we have studied. And from the renal pelvis area, that is the top part. It acts as a that is the renal pelvis functions as a funnel, and it leads to the ureters, leave the kidney from there. And main function is this. When we are talking of the collecting tubule can absorb large amount of water. So the collecting tubules collecting tubules have the capacity, that means the cells as such, that means the large amount of water is reabsorbed. Now, this is the reason we are able to understand that in spite of filtering about 180 liters of blood, we are producing only 1 to 1.5 liters of urine, because large amount of water is reabsorbed in the portion of collecting tubules, and as a result the concentrated urine is produced. Concentrated urine production takes place. So the renal tubular system is very useful in maintaining the ionic balance as well as the filtration. Now this area also allows the small amount of urea into the medullary interstitium. What happens over here, you have to understand that this area is the medullary region and this is the cortex region. Over here the filtration has taken place, and after this the filtrate passes through over here. Now this medullary region has certain amount of osmolarity, that means certain amount of osmotic pressure is there. The release of water by the descending limb and the release of the electrolytes or by the ascending limb of Henle's loop allow the medullary osmotic pressure to be maintained so as to allow the proper filtration again and the reabsorption of useful substances. Also this helps in concentrating, as the fluid is passing through the tubular system the concentrated urine is produced, but it is also important to maintain the medullary osmotic pressure, otherwise the urine will not be filtered. So therefore this area also releases certain amount of urea. So if the concentration of the urea will be more over here outside and inside it is low, it will flow back into the system where it will be excreted out. But if the amount of the urea will be very very less over here, as a result more amount of urea will be passed to this area. So this actually helps in maintaining the movement of the ions, and therefore the osmolarity is very very important to be maintained in this medullary region. The processes are regulated by two major hormones, that is aldosterone and vasopressin. We'll be studying about this in the next video, where aldosterone hormone and vasopressin hormone play an important role in the movement or maintaining the ionic balance within the kidney.